Hello everyone and welcome to the webinar on 4G LTE technology by TELCOMA. So in this webinar, we are going to discuss about 4G LTE technology, its architecture, its use cases and key features which are there in 4G LTE technology. So let's start with the webinar. Hello and welcome to everyone. So 4G technology. So it is the fourth generation of cellular broadband network technology. So a 4G system must be able to provide all the capabilities which are defined by ITU in IMT advanced requirements. International Telecommunication Union has set up some IMT advanced requirements, and those require LTE's long-term evolution for this. So it is the fourth generation. Now everybody is using 4G LTE technology, which is the fourth generation of the cellular broadband network technology. So let's discuss about this. So before LTE technology, let's discuss about what are IMT advanced requirements for this technology. So we have some certain set of requirements. Now, what are the requirements? First, that 4G network should be able, or it should be based on all IP packet switch network. Now 2G, as we know, that is a circuit switch network. Then 3G also circuit switch, packet switch. Now, but here LTE or 4G technology should be based on all IP packet switch network. So this is the first requirement of IMT advanced, that the 4G network should be complete IP network. It should be based on all IP packet switch network. Now moving to the next requirement is about the peak data rate. Peak data rate of this is approximately 100 Mbps for high mobility users and 1 Gbps for local wireless access, or we can say for stationary users. So this is the second requirement about the data rate. Peak data rates of approximately 100 Mbps for high mobility users and 1 gigabit per second for stationary users or for local wireless access, we can say. This is the second IMT advanced requirement. Now comes the third, that it can use scalable channel bandwidth. Now there is no concept of the fixed bandwidth. Now we are using the concept of scalable channel bandwidth of 5 to 20 megahertz and optionally up to 40 megahertz. What is this optionally up to 40 megahertz? This is with the help of carrier aggregation concepts, we can make it 40 megahertz. So use of scalable channel bandwidth, as in 2G or 3G, we have a concept of fixed channel bandwidth. Now 4G is going to use the concept of scalable channel bandwidth of 5 to 20 megahertz, which can be expandable up to 40 megahertz with the help of carrier aggregation concept. Next is, it should have a peak link spectral efficiency. Moving to the next, it is spectral efficiency, which is 15 bits per second. It should be able to meet this requirement. So next, have peak link spectral efficiency, 4 megahertz and 3 are going to discuss about this also. So next, it should have smooth handovers. Yes, the webinar has already started. You can check your camera and mic. It has started. Now, it should, another requirement, that there should be smooth handovers across heterogeneous networks, or we can say HETnet. That means the different networks, it should give a smooth handovers between different networks. Next requirements. It should have high quality of service, as it is a latest technology as compared to the 2G and 3G. It should follow, or it should give a high quality of service. Interoperability with existing wireless standards. It should be able to work with the existing wireless standards, and there should be seamless connectivity and global roaming across the globe. So these are the IMT advanced requirements. Now, what are the key features of this technology? What are the 4G technology key features? That means, what are the technology which are used in this to fulfill all the requirements. So the first is MIMO. MIMO is multiple input, multiple output, multi-input, multiple output. Like we have discussed about SISO, single input, single output, SIMO, single input, multiple output. Like this, we have multiple input and multiple output. That means we are using multiple transceivers, transmitters, and multiple receivers. So why MIMO technology is used in 4G technology? That means to obtain high spectral efficiency by means of spatial progressing, including multi-antenna and multi-user MIMO. These concepts are able to accommodate multiple users and multiple layers for data transmission so that data throughput will increase. So for example, you have a single antenna. Now we are using two or four antennas, so capacity and data throughput will increase. Next is frequency domain equalization should be there. Link adaptation. What is link adaptation? Link adaptation is a feature, or it is the ability to adapt multiple modulation schemes and coding rate in a system. So mobile IP utilized for mobility, for high mobility services, and IP based femtocells should be there. Femtocells are the small cells in the network. So now let's discuss about the frequency bands, 4G or LTE technology frequency bands. Let's discuss about these bands. So MCS is a modulation coding scheme. All the queries we will handle in email support or at the end of the webinar. So now 4G frequency bands. It has a variety of frequency bands. Like all the frequency bands are divided into two categories, FDD and TDD. FDD as frequency division duplex and TDD time division duplex. Like this, all the frequency bands are divided into two categories. FDD bands are also there and TDD bands are also there. Now let's start with the frequency bands. Let's see what are the different frequency bands that we have in LTE. Now we can see this is the LTE band number. You can start with the 33, 34, 35. And this is allocation in megahertz. Like 33 is the number. This is 1900 to 1920. And width of the channel or bandwidth is 20 megahertz. So as we can see that there is only one division from 1900. So this is a TDD band. In FDD, we have a separate for uplink and separate for downlink. So LTE band number, allocation and width of the channel you can see here. These are the FDD frequency bands. These are TDD frequency bands. In FDD frequency bands, we have band number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Uplink frequency different and downlink frequency. This is the total width. Duplex spacing like 1920 to 1980, 2110 to 2170, different for uplink and downlink. Again, FDD bands. So these are all the frequency bands. Band number 15 are now obsolete. Now, what are the key enabling technologies which are used in LTE? Let's start with the enabling technology. What are the different technology? So first is the MIMO technology. As we have discussed, MIMO is a multiple input and multiple output. So what is this technology? MIMO is basically a method of multiplying the capacity of a radio link. See, if I have this as a transmitter and receiver and I have only one link, so this is the capacity of the radio link. So if we are using multiple transmitters and multiple receivers, so we are increasing the capacity of the radio link. So that means MIMO is a method of multiplying the capacity of the radio link using multiple transmitting and multiple receiving antennas. So as we have one transmitter and receiving antenna between the two ends, the capacity is less. So as we are multiplying it with number of transmitters and receivers. So we are increasing or we are multiplying the capacity. This is what MIMO technology is. We have 4x4 is the advanced MIMO technology. That means 4 transmitters, 4 receivers at the end. So MIMO technology is the very first technology key enabling feature. That means to meet all the IMT advanced requirements, we require to add on this technology in a system. To have the peak data rate of about 4x4 is the MIMO in LTE systems, LTE advanced systems that we are using. Now, would we have different modes for MIMO? As we have discussed, single antenna, single transmitter, single receiver. Transmitter diversity, 2 transmitters. Open loop spatial multiplexing, closed loop spatial multiplexing. Then we are using closed loop with pre-coding also, multi-user MIMO to accommodate multiple users. Beamforming and the MIMO concepts. These are all the MIMO modes. It could be clear with this diagram. Let's focus on this. So this is a MIMO technology. Here, this is E node B with 4 transmitter. You can see here 4 transmitter. It is expanded like this. 1, 2, 3, and 4. Here, this is 4x4 MIMO. Basically, MIMO is also different. Like we have 2x2, 2x4, 4x2, 4x4. So this is 4x4 MIMO. So multiple layers are there for multiple data transmissions and high-speed transmissions. So next is OFDMA concept. First is the MIMO technology and next is OFDMA concept. OFDMA as orthogonal frequency division multiple axis. So what is OFDMA? Like we have FDMA, frequency division multiple axis. Then we have FDMA, CDMA, TDMA as time division multiple axis, co-division multiple axis. But here in LTE, we are using orthogonal frequency division multiple axis. It is a multi-user version of OFDMA digital modulation scheme. It is basically a digital modulation scheme. So here in this form of transmission, it uses large number of closely spaced carriers, which are modulated together with low rate data. So carriers are modulated together, but they are modulated in that sense that each and every carrier is orthogonal to one another. So these signals would be expected to interfere with each other. But by making the signals orthogonal to each other, there is no interference. So this is achieved by having the carrier spacing equal to the reciprocal of the symbol period. We have made each and every symbol orthogonal to one another so that they are not able to interfere with one another. So what is the multiple axis we are using in LTE as OFDMA? So we can see here, OFDMA technology, we have 3 axes, power, time, and frequency axis. You can see these are the power. So these are the carriers, pilot subcarriers and data subcarriers are there. These are OFDMA symbols. SC-FDMA. So now OFDMA is the multiple axis that we are using for downlink, but SC-FDMA we are using for the uplink. Why different? In order to reduce or lower the PAPR, which is peak to average power ratio, we are using SC-FDMA in the uplink and OFDMA in the downlink. SC-FDMA is single carrier frequency division multiple axis. It is a frequency division multiple axis scheme. So here we can see the difference between the two. You can see one carrier is divided into 8 parts. Here, this is the single one. And the capacity is equivalent. 180 kilohertz, 180 kilohertz. 12 into 15K, here 15K in one part is 12, so 180 kilohertz. So multiple subcarrier resource blocks and single carrier resource block to lower the PAPR values. We are using SC-FDMA in the uplink and OFDMA in the downlink. Next, bandwidth, total bandwidth. See, the bandwidth defined by the standards are 1.4, 3, 5, 10, 15, and 20. These are all the bandwidths which are defined by the standards. So this is the least bandwidth, but this bandwidth is not able to give you the more data rate. Similar with the 3 megahertz, because these bandwidth concepts are there in the 2G, 3G also. So it has very less number of resource block. See, 20 is the maximum without carrier aggregation concept. 20 megahertz can give you 100 resource block. If we move to the 15 megahertz channel bandwidth, it can give you the 75 resource block. 10 and 50, like this we have a division. So all your queries will be handled in email support. Next is, this is LTE bandwidth. So we have discussed about, this is the LTE bandwidth. It is giving you these multiple bandwidth. 20 megahertz, we say it is giving you 100 resource blocks. How it is calculated? We have a separate calculations for this also. Now, resource block. What is this resource block? Basically, it is the smallest unit of resources that can be allocated to the user. So if this is a time frame, subframe, and this is the smallest slot. If we expand this, so this is the resource block. This is the smallest unit of resources that can be allocated to the user. So one resource block has 12 subcarriers. You can see these are the 12 subcarriers and 7 symbols. So 12 multiplied by 7, if we multiply 12 with the 7, so this number will give you 84 is the number which will are the total resource elements. That means this is the smallest. This is the resource element, smallest. And this block is a resource block. So what we can allocate to the user as one resource block. One is the least number that can be allocated to the user. Suppose if you are having 100 resource block, you can get more data rate. If you are having less resource block, you can get less data rate. So if you are getting 20 megahertz, more resource block, more data throughput, these are the least. So resource block is also a new concept, which are, no, it is not always 7 symbols, it could be 6 also, with the help of cyclic prefix, normal cyclic prefix, and extended cyclic prefix. Now let's move to the architecture of 4G. So this is 4G network architecture. So network architecture always comprises three parts. First, user equipment it should have. Next, E-UTRAN, Evolved Universal Terrestrial Radio Access Network. Now in 4G, we have E as Evolved. Then evolved packet core, which is a new packet core. Now we are not going to reuse the existing core. Network. equipment, E-UTRAN, and evolved packet core. The high-level network architecture of LTE always comprises of three parts. It is user equipment, then we have evolved universal terrestrial radio access network, that means the RAN, and the core network, evolved packet core. So this is the 4G network architecture you can see here. UE as a user equipment. This UE is connected to E-UTRAN, which is the radio access network, with the help of UU interface. So UU is the interface between the UE and E-UTRAN. Then E-UTRAN is connected to evolved packet core with the help of S1 interface. So S1 is the interface between the E-UTRAN and the evolved packet core. Then evolved packet core is connected to the external service PDNs with the help of SGI interface. So this is the 4G network architecture. UE is connected to E-UTRAN, evolved packet core, and the external servers or PDN, packet data networks. So moving to the next, detailed architecture. So this is the detailed architecture. Now let's focus on this architecture and learn about this. As I have teach you that UE is connected to E-UTRAN with the help of UU interface. So this interface is the UU interface through which we are connected to E node B. So E node B is evolved node B. Node B is there in 3G. Now in 4G, we have E node B. So here, two E node Bs are connected to one another with the help of X2 interface. So X2 is the interface between two E node Bs. So this is one E node B, another E node B. X2 is the interface between two E node Bs. So E-UTRAN is connected to EPC with the help of S1 interface. So S1 is of two types, S1U and S1MME. We also say it as S1C. S1U as a user plane and S1C as a control plane, which is also called as S1MME. Your answer is there in a lecture. Please wait for a while. Your queries will be handled. Now, S1U as a user plane, it is responsible for carrying all the data. And moving to the next, which is a control plane, this is for all the signaling. So SGW, let's move to the core network, evolved core network, which is all IP based. Now, this is the new core network, which is not, we are not going to reuse a 3G or 2G core. Now, this is the new core. MME is mobility management entity. We have SGW serving gateway. We have PGW PDN gateway. And this is a PDN or an internet, public data networks. This is PCRF, policy control radio function. This is MME, mobility management. And this is home subscriber subsystem. Now, these are all the entities. S1U, S1 is of two types. S1U is connected to SGW. SGW is connected to PGW with the help of S5, S8 interface. And SGI is the interface between PGW and PDN or internet. These are the entities or all the interfaces in our network. If I divide this part like this, see the diagram. If I divide like this, these are all for signaling. And this is responsible for data handling or transfer of data. So that's why this is for control plane and this is for user plane. So I can say that evolved packet core is divided into two planes. This is the control plane and the user plane, which is there in evolved packet core. Now let's discuss about each and every entity. First of all, let's start with user equipment. That means your mobile handset. It comprises of modules. What are the modules? It should have mobile termination, that means which handle all the communication functions, terminal equipment, which terminates the data stream, and SIM card, which is also called like universal integrated circuit card. E-UTRAN. E-UTRAN handles the radio communication between the mobile and evolved packet core, and it has only one component, not like in 2G or 3G, which has two components. In E-UTRAN part, it has only one component, which is evolved node B. So E-node B is basically a base station that controls the mobile in one or more cells. So E-node B, what are the functions of the evolved node B? It sends and receives radio transmission to all the mobiles, sends and receives the radio transmissions. It controls the low level operations for all mobiles by sending the signaling messages such as handover command, paging commands, etc. So at the low level, it is managing all the mobile stations. Moving to the next, core networks. This is EPC functions. It is the framework. It provides voice and video on a LTE network. It comprises of MME, HSS, SGW, PGW, PCRF, as we have discussed in a diagram. So let's start with the first, which is MME. This is basically the heart of the network. Like we have MSE. Here we have for signaling, we have MME. It is the main signaling node in the EPC. So it is responsible for initiating paging and authentication of a mobile device. This MME is responsible for initiating all the paging and authentication of the mobile device. It retains the local information of the tracking area level. See, if I have to track a user here in LTE, like you have location area, routing area. Here in LTE, we have the tracking areas. So MME retains the local information at the tracking area level for each user, and then it selects the appropriate gateway during the initial registration process of a UE. So basically, it is the central controller of the network. It is responsible for all the signaling or control information. It is there for authentication. It is there for paging. It is responsible for giving a appropriate tracking area or giving a suitable gateway for data stream or registration process it handles. So this is MME. Please, all your queries will be supported in email support. Give me time to explain what I'm explaining to other people. So next is HSS. This is basically a concatenation of HLR and AUC. You have discussed about HLR in 2G, 3G, AUC, authentication center, home location register. So HSS in LTE network, it is responsible for user identification and addressing. It is responsible for user profile information management, etc. So all the authentication of a UE, user identification and addressing will be handled by HSS. You can find PPT and the recorded webinar on our website or YouTube channel. So please learn what I am explaining. So HSS. Next is, yes, you are open to put your queries anytime, anywhere. Here, thank you. SGW. So serving gateway. It serves as a local mobility anchor. Like you have in 3G or 2G SGSN. Why I am comparing with 2G or 3G? Because it will be able to grasp what this entity is. So it serves as a local mobility anchor. Here in this, packets are routed through the point of intra-uterine mobility and mobility with the other 3GPP technologies. So it is basically for packet transmission, packet routing. Everything will be handled by the serving gateway. Main data node in the LTE network is SGW. Next is PDN gateway. We call it as PGW. It is the termination point of a packet data towards the packet data network. So packet data network is there, then this is connected to PGW. PGW is connected to SGW. It is forwarding packet. See, we have to upload or we have to download all the packets. So in case of uploading, we are transmitting from UE, E-node B, SGW, PGW, relevant, and then PDN, packet data network. For downloading from PDN to PGW, PGW, SGW, SGW, E-node B, and then UE. But this path will be allocated and suitable serving gateway will be allocated by MME because it is the main signaling node. So this is PGW. PCRF, it serves as policy. Like, it manages all the policies, sends the quality of service settings information for each session and accounting rule. Like, we have different QS classes as per the services. LTE is offering a number of services, video streaming services. We have voice, also packet data, video gaming is also there. So each and every service has its own quality of service and it has to fulfill or follow that also. So PCRF is responsible for managing all the policies and QS settings. Now, differences between 4G and 3G. Obviously, if we are moving from 3G to 4G, there are multiple differences and it starts with your handset also. So if you talk about the handset, like your 3G handset will not able to support the 4G, but 4G handset will be able to support the 3 because there is always backward compatibility in the system. Say if you are planning, if you have to plan a network, so if you have to plan LTE, suppose, there should always be backward compatibility because you can't remove all the 3G network and install new 4G network everywhere you want. So somewhere in some areas, first you have 4G, then it should hand over to 3G in some areas, even in 2G in some areas, backward areas. So here, it started with the low level. That means your handset also required changes because your handset is able to have more data as provided by the network. It should be able to process the data faster. It should be more secure, like 4G is more secure as compared to 3G. So security algorithm should be there in your SIM card. So if you see what is the difference between the 4G and the 3G SIM card, obviously security is one of the reason. It should be able to support all the codes which are able to provide, which are provided by the network. So differences between 3G and 4G. So 4G is the fourth generation and 3G is the third generation. So it includes IP telephony, gaming, HDTV, video conferencing, whereas 3G voice telephony is there, mobile TV, video calls, and web access is provided by the 3G. These are the services which are provided by these different networks. So data rate is also one of the reason. This is the data throughput per user, not the peak one. It is written here. It offers this much and 4G offer data throughput more. Now, more in this, like 4G is giving us with the help of voice over LTE concept. Voice over LTE is the IP voice. Like in any Skype or you are using voice software tool, we have a IP voice in 4G network we call as voice over LTE networks. That is not on a circuit switch network. The voice is not on a circuit switch network. That is your IP based voice. That is possible with the help of voice over LTE concept in this technology. That is also 4G technology, voice over LTE, like this network. The network architecture that we have discussed which is completely for data, not for voice. Voice over LTE has a different network architecture. That is a different concept which are used in this to handle your IP voice. This is for data rate. Now your question is why data throughput is higher in LTE than 3G? Because in 3G we are not using MIMO and advanced technologies to handle more. And if you want a new generation, you require more data rate. Because what we are focusing on to have more data rate in advanced technologies, like in 5G, more data rate, almost much time higher than that of 4G. So similarly, 4G requires 4G data throughput is higher in LTE than in 3G because we are moving from 3G to 4G for data rate only. For security, for data rate, for more services, these services which we have written over here, IP telephony, gaming, HD video require more data rate. That's why It is giving you more data rate. That's why we have these services. Now, 4G offers peak upload rate of 500 Mbps compared to 3G, which is offer around peak. Now, here, there is a difference P in peak and the offer data rate. Here, we have written peak one, which is 5 Mbps. And download 1 Gbps compared, which is giving you offer 100 Mbps. 4G network architecture is based on the integration of wireless LAN and wide area network. So this 3G architecture is wide area cell based only. 3G is using a concept of WCDMA, wideband co-division multiple access, where for multiple access in 4G technology, we are using a concept of OFDMA. So 4G uses frequency bands of 2 to 8 gigahertz, which uses 1.8 to 2.85 gigahertz. 4G is based on OFDMA technology compared to 3G, which is based on WCDMA technology. As I told you, here we are in 3G, we have used wideband co-division multiple access, whereas 4G is orthogonal frequency division multiple access for the downlink and SC-FDMA for the uplink. See, we have used multiple key technologies so that we can improve the data rate. So MIMO is the technology, latest technology that we have used in the 4G. Multiple access we have changed from WCDMA to OFDMA and SC-FDMA. So like this, there are multiple, and also the main difference that we have changed the architecture, network architecture in 4G for the improvement in data rate. Here we don't, we have all IP network, we have a faster network. As we are moving with different new generation, we have a faster nodes, faster processors. So we are using faster nodes and faster networks so that we can improve, or we can have more data rate compared to the previous generation, because we have to move ahead. We have to increase the throughput. We have to move ahead. Like in 5G also, we are moving ahead with the more data rate. So this is the 4G technology, a brief introduction of 4G technology that we have discussed in today's webinar. So thank you all for attending this webinar. We will look forward for new webinars on different technologies. So thank you everyone for attending and listening to this webinar. You can find all your queries. We can provide email support. You can drop an email for all your queries related to this webinar. And you can find this recorded version in our website or YouTube. So thank you all for participating. Thank you so much. Yes, we can share the PPT. Yes, we can share PPT. So thank you everyone for participating. Thank you for your comments and thank you for listening to this webinar.